Welcome to the fourth session in the webinar series, Applying Best Practices to Diverse Older Adults, sponsored by the Stanford Geriatric Education Center in collaboration with the California Area Health Education Centers, American Geriatric Society, and Natividad Medical Center. My name is Christopher Matola, and I will be your host for the session. We are very happy to have you join with us today as we present the program on Fall Risk and Prevention in Older Adults. If you have questions during the presentation, please use the chat feature on the screen. The presenters will respond to the questions in the Q&A session at the end of their presentations. If you need to communicate with the presenters directly after the session, you may do so by sending an email to stanfordgec@stanford.edu. At the conclusion of the webinar, please complete the short evaluation questionnaire. For those of you who have requested continuing education credits for attending the webinar, the evaluation is required. We need to let you know that the webinar is not supported by any commercial interest, and today's presenters have no financial relationships to disclose. And now, I would like to introduce the clinician, educator, and an assistant professor of medicine in the Division of Geriatrics, Department of Medicine, University of California, San Francisco, Dr. Josette Rivera.
Hi, so thank you for joining us in this webinar on fall risk and prevention in older adults. So let's dive in with a few case examples. So this slide is to show that everybody falls, young, old, and as my co-presenter Ellen Corman will say, falls cross party lines with both Democrats and Republicans, as well as young and old. And so, for example, the circumstances that led to Lady Gaga's fall was very different from those that led to Ed McMahon's fall. And so today we're focusing on falls specifically in older adults who live in the community, not in nursing homes or in hospitals. So to start off with some quick trivia, do you know who these gentlemen are? So the first one on the top left is a little bit more challenging. That's Dr. Robert Adkin of the Adkins Diet fame. And who is the gentleman on the bottom right? I'm assuming somebody knows it's Kurt Vonnegut, the author. And what do you think these men had in common besides having had a fall? They both died as a result of complications from their falls. So these examples are to illustrate that falls are very common and with potentially devastating consequences. And I will argue that all of us, everyone in the audience of this webinar, have an important part in fall prevention. So hopefully today, by the end of this discussion, you should be able to understand the personal and societal impact of falls, identify risk factors for falls among older adults, describe evidence-based guidelines for screening and prevention, and discuss interventions that have been demonstrated to reduce falls. So first, this may seem obvious, but several fall definitions exist in the literature. So what is a fall? It's unintentionally coming to rest on the ground or other lower level. And it's not due to a major intrinsic event, like a seizure or a stroke, or an overwhelming environmental hazard, like getting hit by a bus. And it also does not entail a loss of consciousness. So why do we care? Why should we care? Well, for one, injuries are the fifth leading cause of death in older adults, and complications resulting from falls are the leading cause of death from injury. So you could see at the top of the pyramid almost 15,000 deaths as a result of a fall. But I also want to draw your attention to the bottom of the pyramid, millions of untreated fall injuries. Why do you think this is? What do you think is going on? So there's many potential reasons that many falls go undetected. The patient may never mention the fall, and the care provider never asks. The patient and or the provider attaches no significance to the fall. There was no injury at the time of fall. And the incorrect assumption that falls are just a normal part of aging. which is not true, and in fact, falls are a leading cause of morbidity and mortality among older adults. 40% of falls result in minor injuries, 10% result in major injuries such as fractures, traumatic brain injuries, and lacerations. 2.2% of injurious falls result in death. And the cost of fall-related injuries for older adults is currently estimated at $19 billion, which is estimated to balloon up to almost $55 billion by 2020. So these injuries, deaths, and costs represent an enormous burden to patients, society, and our healthcare system. And falls are not only associated with greater morbidity and mortality, but are also linked to reduced overall functioning and early admission to long-term care facilities. Fallers are 3 times more likely to enter a skilled nursing facility. And I will also say, half of those who survive a fall never return to their prior level of mobility or independence. Are these outcomes that matter to people? In fact, one study found that 80% of older women preferred death to a bad hip fracture that would result in a nursing home admission. I also want to mention that simply the fear of falling is also an increasingly recognized and important entity that leads to social isolation and further functional decline. In a prospective cohort study of about 670 community-dwelling older adults who had fallen, were followed over a period of 3 years, 60% reported moderate activity restriction, and this was self-restriction, and 15% reported severe restriction. And at the period of 3 years, they found that both moderate and severe restriction led to worsening disability in their activities of daily living. And this was consistent even after accounting for other potential explanations or confounders. So with that framework, who falls? So now here's a question, a poll, to see who's paying attention and who's multitasking. So what percent of adults over 65 years old living in the community fall each year? 5%, 10%, 20%, 30%, or 50%? Go ahead and register your answer. Okay, some of you are still thinking. About one more second. Okay, so most of you are not answering the question, but the answer is 30%. The poll is starting to close before I can advance the slide. Okay, sorry about that. So let's see. So the final answer is 30%. I was looking at the span, the range of answers here. So 30% of community-dwelling people over the age of 65 fall each year, and this increases to 50% for those 80 years and older. And of those, half are repeat fallers. So another question, this time I think you get five minutes to answer this question, or 5 seconds, sorry. Which ethnic groups are most likely to fall? African Americans, Asian Americans, Latino Americans, European Americans, or no difference? Okay, so the majority answered no difference, when in fact, Latinos are the most likely to fall, and this is from the 2007 California Health Interview Survey. And I actually looked at the last set of data from 2003, and the answer was about the same. So Latinos have the most, whites are next, and interestingly, Asians the least. Anecdotally, we've recently found that there's several ways to ask about falls in Chinese. So it may be that their prevalence is not really lower. It's just that we're not asking the right questions, which leads to underreporting. Okay, so last question. Which ethnic group is most likely to be hospitalized because of a fall? African Americans, Asian Americans, Latino Americans, European Americans, or no difference between groups? Okay, so most people got the answer correct, which was European Americans. This data is relatively old, from 95, 97, but I suspect it probably still holds true. That rates per 100,000 for hospitalized fall injuries for whites was significantly higher than all other groups. And they were also more likely to have a fracture diagnosis that led to the admission and to be discharged to long-term care facilities rather than home. So for community-dwelling older adults, effective fall prevention has the potential to reduce serious fall-related injuries, emergency department visits, hospitalizations, nursing home placements, and functional decline. And I'd like to call your attention to the American Geriatric Society Fall Prevention Guidelines, and the web link is here on this slide. It's a very practical, I think, useful clinical tool that looks like this. And it's an algorithm that walks you through from evaluation to treatment. So what is the first step in fall prevention? And that is screening. So according to the American Geriatric Society, all adults over 65 should be asked at least annually if they've fallen in the past year or whether they have difficulties in gait or balance. And they go through, this part of the algorithm is a little bit more complicated, but basically my interpretation is that if there's one fall, check balance and gait. If there are recurrent falls or subjective or objective balance gait disturbance, then do a multifactorial fall risk assessment, which we'll speak about in a minute. So moving on to evaluation of the faller. So the first thing to think about when somebody reports a fall is to rule out what I call acute badness. And first of all, to address syncope. The evaluation of syncope and falls have some overlap, but they're different. And syncope accounts for only a small minority of falls. It's key to diagnose, but it often will not be relevant. I think about falls like delirium, a sign of something else going on underlying that could be bad. For example, urinary tract infection, pneumonia, heart attack, stroke, medication changes. Other relevant parts of the fall's history include thinking about comorbidities, the type and number of medications or recent changes, to keep in mind substance alcohol use, also subjective difficulty with walking or balance, ability to complete activities of daily living, such as bathing, dressing, toileting, grooming, as well as the fear of falling. In terms of the physical evaluation, one gait expert told me that you have not fully examined either the nervous or musculoskeletal systems until you have analyzed the gait. There are many ways to do this. What I use is a very quick validated test that requires no special equipment or training, just a chair and 10 feet marked off on the floor. And that test is the timed up and go. It's a frequently recommended screening test for mobility, and it takes less than 1 minute. I like it because it correlates well with other more detailed scales, but it's very quick and easy to do. So the way this works is, first of all, the patient has to be able to follow instructions, and they're allowed to use their usual walking aid, if any. And the patient begins seated in a chair, and you ask them, him or her, to stand up, walk 10 feet, which is marked on the floor, turn around, walk back, and sit back down, and you time that. There are different cutoff times in literature, but I use greater than 14 seconds, which is associated with an increased risk of falls. However, there is no uniform agreement as to which cutoff score is the most useful. In addition to the time component, there is also a judgment part. It's what you observe, and if you observe anything unsafe or ineffective that suggests balance or gait impairment and increased risk of falling, I would recommend the patient be referred to physical therapy for a complete evaluation and treatment. Now, how that actually happens obviously depends on insurance and specific situations. And in our populations, options might include the outpatient setting, an adult day health center, or home care if the patient is homebound. Other relevant aspects of the physical exam would include supine and standing blood pressure, vision and hearing, again, neurologic musculoskeletal, not forgetting feet and the type of footwear, and inappropriate assistive device use. So now turning to etiology and risk factors, often the treatment of fall-related injuries does not include thinking about the cause of the fall, unfortunately. So many studies have documented important risk factors for falling, which are often classified as either intrinsic or extrinsic. So intrinsic to the patient, these are just some examples that might include medical conditions such as peripheral neuropathy, foot problems, arthritis, impaired vision or hearing, age-related changes that might include increased reaction time, decreased reflexes, etc. Extrinsic factors might include medications, particularly any that are acting on the central nervous system, antihypertensives, improper use of assistive devices such as walkers or canes, and hazards in the environment. And my co-presenter, Ellen Corman, is going to review this in more detail. Mary Tanetti, who is the national expert on falls, did a systematic review of the fall risk factor literature. And of the 33 studies reviewed, the falling risk factors here were the most commonly studied. And top of the list was previous falls. So patients who've had a previous fall are extremely high risk of falling again, as with balance impairment, as one might expect. And perhaps as important as identifying risk factors is appreciating the interaction and probable synergism between multiple risk factors. So several studies have shown that the risk of falling increases linearly and dramatically as the number of risk factors increases. So this is one particular study of patients followed over a year, and those with no risk factors had 8% chance of falling, and that skyrocketed to about 80% of patients who had 4 or more risk factors. So to summarize this presentation so far, just to summarize that falls are common, multifactorial. They have devastating and important consequences that lead to injuries, functional decline, nursing home placement, and death. It is important to screen older adults for falls at least annually. I actually ask at every visit. The evaluation should include assessments of risk factors, gait, and the home. Targeted multifactorial interventions are most effective, which we'll cover in a minute. There are fall prevention guidelines that are evidence-based and available. And interprofessional collaboration is essential. All health professions have a role in fall prevention. So now I will hand it over to Ellen Corman, who is Supervisor of Community Outreach and Injury Prevention at the Trauma Center of Stanford University Medical Center. Okay, so I represent a trauma center over at Stanford University Medical Center. As a level one trauma center, we are obligated to look at data, at trauma data, and design injury prevention programs to meet the community needs. So for all ages, motor vehicle collisions really are the greatest cause of injury. But when you look at older adults, who we view as 65 years and older, the greatest number of admissions to a trauma center are falls. As you can see, almost 75% of traumas in the Stanford University Medical Center Trauma Center were brought there because of a fall. I know we're there are people all over the country looking at this data. I wanted to look at the data for our trauma center that was very close to home, and that's Santa Clara County. And in Santa Clara County, that in 2006, we had over 2,600 hospitalizations due to falls. And the average cost of that hospitalization was over $38,000. Just a 911 call that would bring somebody from home to hospital is close to $1,500. So we certainly know that the cost of falls are both horrible in terms of its physical toll on the older adult and their family, but the financial toll is also significant. So that went over a little bit about why do people fall. I'll just do a very quick review. So we know that people fall because of health issues. They may include things like diabetes or Parkinson's or peripheral neuropathy or other things that may cause difficulty with gait and balance, weakness, and other things that can contribute to our risk for falling. Medications, it's the number, the type, and the combination of prescription, over-the-counter, and herbals altogether that can cause fall risk. And that could, we know that the number four is that magical number that people think about where if you have four or more medications, that significantly increases your risk for falling. We recommend that that older adults consider taking all of their medications, which include over-the-counter and herbal, to a pharmacist or their primary care physician on a very regular basis to have them looked at. And then personal habits. Personal habits may include things like alcohol use and the choices that people make in terms of the amount of alcohol they drink definitely contributes to the risk of falling. Vision is another risk factor. When you think about acuity, we use our eyes to be able to look at our environment, and if we see something in our path, we can maybe step over something, step around something. But if we can't see something, we can't avoid it, and that that creates a fall risk for us. We also know that multifocal lenses increase your chance of falling. And so wearing single focal lenses and having good lighting contribute to safety. Home safety. You know, the CDC reports that about 50% of falls happen in the home. We may not be able to control the outside environment, uneven surfaces outside, uneven stairs, those kind of things. But we spend a considerable amount of time in our own homes, and we should be able to control our own home environment. That means looking at each room in the home and being able to see what type of things we can do to be able to make that home safer, from the bedrooms to the stairwells to the bathrooms. And we often recommend that somebody pick up their throw rugs. And why? People say, but I've had the throw rug in my home forever. It feels like, you know, I got it when I was on a trip to Europe, or it protects my floor, or all the other reasons that we keep throw rugs in our homes. But we know that people trip on those area rugs often, and it's not just being able to be secured well on the ground so that they don't crunch and or scrunch up, but it's also that little lip that's created between the floor and the rug. And on a day that we're dragging, even if we don't have a gait that normally would be a dragging, if we're tired, if we're sick, we may not pick up our feet that well, and then we catch our foot and fall. When we talk about grab bars, it's just common sense that slippery surfaces, hard surfaces, things in the bathroom have areas that create more fall risk. And having something to hold on to is something that is a very, very simple, low-cost fix for somebody. Personal habits. People love their comfy slippers, their slip-on shoes, their flip-flops, but we know that those also create more of a fall risk, so it's important to be able to take a look at the types of decisions that we're using there. Personal habits can also include things like choosing to be able to step on a step stool or a chair, being able to climb on that ladder. That was to be able to clear the leaves in the gutter that you used to do when you were 40 years old, but should you be doing it when you're 80? And then multitasking. One of the things that you'll ask most often to somebody who, or what we hear most often when we ask somebody, why do you think you fell? They said, I wasn't paying attention. And we often try to be able to, in this busy world, do many things at one time, and we aren't paying attention, and it does create a fall risk. And then lastly, my list here is balance and strength. A weakness can be from the aging process. But sedentary lifestyle contributes to difficulties with balance and strength. Dr. Larry Rubenstein reported in a review of 17 studies that persons with readily identifiable leg weakness have a 4 to 5 time increase in their risk for falls. And persons with impaired gait or balance are 3 times more likely to fall. Best practices in fall prevention show that the best intervention to prevent falls is really multifactorial. Because falls can be caused by so many things, it's important to be able to have multiple interventions to be able to fix that. Again, if you ask an older adult, why did you fall? Or they might tell you, well, I tripped on the uneven pavement on the sidewalk. So you say, okay, so it was an environmental cause for the fall. I'll fix the crack. But then we might want to ask the question, did everybody who walked by that crack in the sidewalk fall? Why did this crack cause this person to fall? And perhaps it was really a gait and balance issue. Perhaps it was something where when their foot caught and they went to lose balance, they didn't have the physical strength to right themselves, and that fall, that unbalance created the fall. Or perhaps it was something that had to do with the medications that person was taking. But because it's hard for somebody to analyze their own way, they may not be able to tell you, well, I was taking 7 medications, and it caused me to be a little dizzy, so I fell. So really, if we look at all the different causes of falls and then try to prepare a multifactorial program, we have the best bang for the buck. Interventions for fall prevention then are really looked at for 4 areas. It's medication review with special attention to psychotropic drugs. It's a home safety assessment and modification, and indeed about 50% of falls are happening in the community, but we have less control of that environment. With 50% of falls happening at home, those are areas that we can take control of and see if we can to have the environment work for us. If you have a tripping hazard in the home, let's say there's a cord in your home that you have the potential to trip over, you might have tripped over it before and been able to right yourself, but that next time you tripped over it, you may not be so lucky. so why take the chance? And then exercise. Type and frequency of exercises are not conclusive at this time. I think that's the question I get asked most often when I speak to groups is what kind and what type. We do know that balance and strength training seem to be most effective, and that the most research out there on effective fall prevention programs for show that Tai Chi is effective at preventing falls and is the only exercise strategy that was really significantly effective in isolation of all other interventions. And then, of course, on this list still, we have to always look at those personal habits and pay some attention to our surroundings and changing our own personal behaviors. At Stanford Hospital, we developed a program in 2005 that took a look at these multifaceted causes and put together a multifaceted intervention program that we call Farewell to Falls. It's a free home-based program that's offered by our hospital. And it is multifaceted, looking at home safety, medication management, strength and balance with exercise and personal habits. Our program sends an occupational therapist out to the patient, or we call them participant home, for two home visits within about a month of each other, and then a third visit 1 year later. We want to look at health, activities of daily living, and other kinds of activity in an interview. Our occupational therapist takes a complete list of medication, including vitamins, minerals, over-the-counter prescription and non-prescription meds, and we send that to our pharmacist here in the hospital for a written review of those medications that could contribute to fall risk. We do a sensory motor assessment. Our get up and go that Josette mentioned is certainly part of that. And we do a home safety assessment. Once we've done some evaluation, then it's important for us to be able to provide some intervention for our participants. When we look at exercise programs, we want to be able to say what is the best exercise somebody can do is something that they will do. So Tai Chi may have been shown to be an effective way to be able to help with strength and balance. But if the older adult has no access or transportation to get to the class or has no interest in being part of that class, then it's not effective for that older adult. A study that was done by King and Haskell here at Stanford University in the early 1990s found that actually home-based exercise is equally beneficial for participants as group-based exercise. It's just that they need to continue to do it. So we, with our Farewell to Falls program, we provide a home-based, we try to encourage them to utilize community-based programs but have a home-based exercise for them as well. And then we need to make sure that once we've identified home safety risks, that they have an opportunity to be able to follow through on them. It doesn't do us any good to have recommendations on a sheet of paper. We need to make sure that we can help to connect our participants to somebody who can help them to be able to install grab bars. We may be able to help them to identify resources in the community to be able to help them clean up their clutter. It's important for us to be able to help them to be able to follow through. We've been fortunate to have some financial assistance to actually be able to support our older adults who have financial difficulties and help them to be able to install those grab bars as well. So in mission criteria to Farewell to Falls, you have to be 65 years and older, live in the two counties that are surrounding our hospital, be ambulatory, falls from wheelchairs are important issues, but not something that our intervention program works with. The same with the ability to be able to follow through on instructions. Those with dementia for Alzheimer's may have significant needs, but if they can't follow through on our recommendations, then they won't be a really good candidate for our program. And they have to be willing to commit to an exercise program and the other recommendations we have. I'm going to go back here for 1 second. So it's really important for us to be able to do those home visits. One of the things I failed to put on my on a slide was that after we do this home visit, we've given them exercises. We actually have a DVD or video that we produced that's just part of the Sit and Be Fit system, and found that many older adults were having difficulty being able to use their equipment. And so that wasn't the perfect solution for some of our older adults to help them with a home exercise program. So we have three options for giving them exercise programs. We have the Tinetti group of exercises is available in series 1 through 5, I believe it is. But we also provide something that we call MAPS. And they're 4 very simple exercises that we feel that people can and are now following up on. One is M stands for marching, and they can do that sitting or standing and marching in place. A stands for ankle rolls, and being able to take your ankle and being able to, your ankle is your stability point. It's the most important muscle or part of your body for being able to deal with balance. Strong ankles are very important, and ankle rolls or ankle circles are very important to do. That's the A. The T stands for what we call TADA. It's something by Dr. Christian Thompson at a U.S. University of San Francisco, and he has an exercise called TADA. If you're interested, I would Google it. He even has it on the YouTube. And the S stands for sit, to stand. Having the muscles to be able to have the strength to go from sitting to standing is another important thing. So we give them our MAPS exercises. Our Farewell to Fall volunteers call our participants at least once a month for a year. We want to make sure that they're not only being given the exercises, but they're doing the exercises. That they're not only being given a report by our pharmacist on medications, but they took that to their primary care physician to discuss with them. That we not only gave them the list of home safety recommendations, but they followed up on it. So our phone calls once a month help us to be able to remind that older adult how important it is to be able to follow through. And then a year later, our occupational therapist returns to the home to reevaluate. I just wanted to mention a few other evidence-based fall prevention programs. One of them that some of you may have heard of is called the Matter of Balance Volunteer Lay Leader Model. It was a program, it's a program of Maine Health that was developed at Rabal Center at Boston University. And it works with older adults that have a fear of falling. Now, Josette had mentioned that 60% of fallers had reported moderate activity restriction, and 15% of fallers had severe restriction of their activities. And we know restriction of activity means that you have you are not using your muscles and can become weaker. So fear of falling may cause seniors to restrict their activity, leading to increasing weakness and a greater risk for falling. Matter of Balance is a center-based program for 8 to 12 seniors. It utilizes facilitated discussion, role-playing, and exercise, helping seniors to see that that their falls can be controllable, and that they can set goals for increasing activity. And it's one of the programs that's recommended by National Council on Aging. Stepping On is a similar program to Matter of Balance. I'm not as familiar with it. I understand that one of the differences between Stepping On and a Matter of Balance is Stepping On is taught by the health professional, and it includes a home visit along with the group sessions. Tai Chi, Moving for Better Balance, is one of the better exercise programs that's been proven to be able to show a decrease in falls. And last is a program called Otago. It's physical therapy based. It is a home-based program out of New Zealand and is worth you checking out if interested. I have some resources that you may be interested in being able to check out. The National Council on Aging has some very, very good information, the CDC, and there was a wonderful article from the Public Health Agency of Canada. So I am going to close this and be able to open the floor for some questions. Okay, so one of the first questions asks that if a dementia client has a caregiver who can follow through with the program recommendations, can we accept them for the program? And that's actually an excellent question. At Stanford, we actually have the luxury of being able to set up this program as a program and not a study. So we do have some flexibility. And if we do have a caregiver who is extremely active, then we do consider accepting people with mild dementia. But as a person gets further into the dementia process, they often have a lot of behaviors and other things that make it a little bit more difficult. So we take it on an individual basis and decide how to provide that service. Oh, so the next question asks, how do you spell the T for exercise in our MATS program? And it actually was T-A-D-A, ta-da. And if you can think about this exercise, it's quite cute. If you're doing it from a standing position, you basically bend your knees and reach over your midline and put your palm out on the just around your to the side, your right hand to the left side of your knee. And then you need to put that arm back up, follow that hand with your eyes, rotate your body, and then you go, ta-da! That's how he came up with that. So you go back and over and go, ta-da! Kind of silly, but it works. Okay, got another question for me, and it says, do we have multi-ethnic staff to make home OT visits for the Farewell to Falls program? Although I actually have multi-ethnic staff, I don't have multilingual staff, which has made the program a little bit more challenging. As a hospital, we have access to a language line, and we have tried to connect people by our language line during our home visit. This is less than perfect in terms of an hour and a half visit. Our first request for a family member is whether they have a family member or a friend who can be there to help translate. And I would say that in probably 90% of the cases that we see, there is a family member or friend who can be there. And in those ones that can't, we do use the language line. The next question asks about revenue sources available to support the Farewell to Falls program. Our program originally started with a very small grant that we got from a community benefits part of another hospital. And then we had a very generous private donor who gave us money that allowed us that program to last for several years. The hospital, though, realized the strength of the program as both a marketing tool, as the right thing to do for being able to be there for the patients in our community and as a community benefit. If your hospital is nonprofit, and if you're coming from a hospital and it's a nonprofit, then you are required to be able to give back to the community. So our hospital uses some community. So right now, Bearwalta Falls is an operating cost of Stanford Hospital and Clinics. Some of those funds are out of our community benefits department, and some of them are just part of the operating expenses of the hospital because they believe it's the right thing to do. But otherwise, community benefits from other hospitals that might be able to be interested in supporting you. There are Area Agency on Aging has access to funds that they like to be able to support community-based, evidence-based programs. So things like A Matter of Balance and Otago are now being able to be looked at a little bit more closely as fundable. Otago, I understand, is actually one of the only programs that has reimbursement possibilities. It is physical therapy based and may have some reimbursement possibilities through Medicare. The next question asked about looking at wear and tear of shoes that older adults wear, and how to judge the wearing down of shoes. That's a really, really good question that I'm not sure I have a scientific answer for. There has been, and I don't have it in front of me, but there was a recent study that looked at shoes. And looked at whether shoes versus socks versus bare feet. And the conclusion was that the use of shoes reduced falls. There were greater falls for those who were both barefoot and had walked in socks. There's also been information out there in terms of shoes with that say that the best types of shoes are well-fitted, thin-soled shoes that have some non-skid on the bottom. But in terms of the wear and tear, I think you just have to take a look and say, does it look too slick? And would somebody therefore have a potential to fall because of that? But I don't know anything really in terms of the specific inches or depth of a shoe.
Hi, this is Josette again, and I agree with that answer. I think the most important thing is that it's a flat sole with a high surface area, and also looking at, you know, the slippery factor of the shoe, but as to, you know, specifically wear and tear, I think that is sort of a judgment factor, and I don't have any hard and fast guidelines on that. Someone asked two questions, I think, for me. One is, why do Latinos have a higher rate of falling? And I don't think anyone knows the answer to that. Possibilities could be in how they report, access to services, the environment. I think there are a lot of potential reasons, and I haven't seen any explanation of that whatsoever. Very, very good question. The second question is, if there are identified high-risk meds, what's the follow-up? And that is also a very good question for which there is no clear answer. The first thing is to refer the identified high-risk medication back to the prescribing practitioner, identifying it as a medication that is causes risk for falls. And at that point, the practitioner can either decide, it has to do a risk-benefit analysis. Is this medication worth the risk of falls? If not, can it be eliminated? Can the dose be reduced? Can we try alternative therapies, such as behavioral therapies or some other kinds of changes? But it is clearly a judgment call on the practitioner's part as to whether the risk of the medication outweighs the risk of falls. And that's a very difficult call, particularly in the case of psychotropic medications that control psychiatric diseases.
I'm going to actually answer something that I failed to bring up before that isn't exactly a specific question, but I often get asked a question about community-based group kinds of intervention programs like A Matter of Balance versus home-based programs like Farewell to Fall. So which one is a better type of program? And I, you know, the answer to that is, if you're trying to set something up, is some of it has to do with how much funds you have available. A program like A Matter of Balance is an inexpensive program to run. You're reaching 8 to 12 older adults at a given time. It is taught by lay leaders who can be volunteers. So it's a much more affordable program if you have the space and the resources to be able to do that. Group-based programs also help in terms of have a social outlet for older adults who often have social isolation, and they can easily learn from their peers. And that is, it can be very, very effective. Home-based programs, though, can be really effective as well in terms of being able to provide services to those hard-to-reach populations. Those that don't have easy access to get to community-based programs. Seeing older adults in their home also allows us to be able to provide that opportunity to point out areas of need. And so we can evaluate right then and then be able to show them where they may want to go and be able to provide them those resources. And in a group, somewhere a center-based program, if you give somebody a checklist perhaps for a home safety eval and then have them go take that home, is a leap of faith that they're going to take that and be able to actually go from room to room and be able to make the right determinations and then follow through. So there are and opportunities to be able to help people with home-based exercise programs also allow those people who have either no interest or no access to community programs have that ability then to be able to have a way to be able to continue to stay physically active, which can help in the strength and balance and decrease their risk for falls. Okay, I'm going to hand this over to Josette. Do you have a question here? Okay. So there was a question about unsafe behaviors and what kind of tips we might have to be able to help an individual choose to be able to make some behavior changes. The question talked about individuals choosing not to use assistive devices or make recommended changes or engage in risking behaviors despite knowledge to the contrary. What suggestions do we have? That is a great question, and I actually don't have a great answer. I think we, you know, being in the home and being able to point things out, being able to try to work with other family members and not just the older adult participant, if we can get the caregiver involved in that, and others. Another thing, though, that I think has been beneficial, when we do sensory motor assessments in their home, and we can show them, you know, sometimes people are not as realistic in terms of their own ability. And if we can do perhaps a sit-to-stand evaluation and say, at your age, Mr. So-and-so, who's 85 years old, you should be able to do, average is doing the following number of sit-to-stands. And you are below that, which places you at higher risk for a fall. If we can point that out and then be able to show them and recommend the different kinds of things that we recommend to be able to reduce their falls, it may sort of connect the dots for some of them. We also want to make sure that the adaptive equipment is something that they understand how to use. You know, we often do hand-me-downs of adaptive equipment. We're asking somebody to use things that aren't comfortable for them. But I know a lot of it has to do with stigma, too. And an older adult doesn't want to look or handicapped often and therefore chooses not to use something in the community. And so being able to talk about that with them, that's one another way, reason that a program's like a matter of valence, where they are a group-facilitated programs where they learn from each other, is often very successful at being able to have somebody understand, wait a minute, somebody else is using their walker, and they found it to be helpful, because when they go out into the community and they have their walker, other people stay a few feet behind, and they feel safer. So they like their walker. I wonder whether that makes sense, and they might make some changes accordingly.
This is Josette again. I agree with that question. It's a really hard balance between respecting a patient's autonomy versus safety, and unfortunately sometimes those are at crosshairs. And what I was going to say is in agreement with Ellen's response is sometimes trying to help people gain insight into their impairments, and when that fails, also recruiting help from caregivers and family and peers. So again, reiterating the importance of community-based programs are that, you know, if patients see other people doing these things and being very successful, it's sort of like a peer pressure. The next question is, do risk factors change with ethnic elders? That's a very good question, and I don't know the answer to that. I've not seen any papers in the literature that break down risk factors by ethnicity.
I think we have time for only one last question, and that question is on the one-year follow-up after the home-based program. What do we test, and what changes are most significant? So we ask how many, whether they have had a fall, whether they have found a, if they did have a fall, whether that required medical assistance. We ask them whether they've spoken to their doctor. We go back around through their home and see whether the changes have been made. But and then we do the same sensory motor assessment that we did on our first visit. And our sensory motor assessment is has a number of components. It's a get up and go. It's a functional reach test. It's the Fullerton Balance Scale. There's a number of things, and we want to see, have they changed, and are they stronger or weaker, or where are they in that scale? So, and have they exercised and followed through? That helps us to be able to determine whether, you know, unfortunately, not everybody does follow through on our recommendations. So it's not a surprise at that point that some of them have shown a decrease instead of an improvement. But that gives us one more opportunity to intervene. Okay, so now you're going down. You're looking like you're going in the wrong direction. Maybe now it's time to be able to take a look at that exercise component again. And we have seen that some of those, we've had some success in the a whole year later, even though we lost that first year.
Thank you very much. That was very, very informative. This is Chris Mottola at the Stanford GEC. This concludes our presentation today on fall risk and prevention in older adults. I would like to thank the presenters, Dr. Josette Rivera and Ms. Ellen Corman. Thank you so much for your participation. If you enjoyed this presentation, please be aware that completion of the survey allows us to continue to get funding. Our next webinar in part two of the series, Tackling the Tough Topics in Ethnogeriatrics, will be on Thursday, June 7th, 12 to 1:30 p.m. Pacific Daylight Time. It will be on an ethnogeriatric perspective on health literacy and medication use in emergency preparedness, and is presented by Drs. Keisha Gant, Melinda McBride, and Edward C. Stemley. Thank you.